Hi, this is your host, Abdul Bharti, and we are here at KubeCon and CloudNativeCon in Salt Lake City, Utah. And today we have with us Matt Maas, lead engineer of Qarik and eGen company. Matt, it's great to have you on the show.
Hi, well, thanks for having me.
I would love to know a bit about Qarik. Tell us about Qarik and what role it plays in this cloud native ecosystem.
Qarik is a Google Cloud partner, and we specialize in large-scale migrations, tech transformations, and things like that to help customers get onboarded to GCP and get their applications up and running in GCP.
You are here at KubeCon. What value or what importance do you see of events like KubeCon for players like Qarik?
I think there's a lot of advantages to KubeCon. I think for me personally, it comes down to a couple of different things. One is staying current with what's happening in the industry, what kind of trends that we see in the industry, and how Kubernetes itself is kind of evolving along those lines. Keeping an eye towards the future, seeing what other organizations, what they're trying to solve for their future problems, and then how Kubernetes fits in there. Such things like AI. There's a big AI conversation happening around the event, and just seeing how other organizations are solving those problems, and leveraging the nature of Kubernetes, the ephemeralness, and how they can use those workloads in their AI environments.
This is kind of technically day one, for attendees. You have been, it's just the morning, beginning of the event, keynotes were there. You have been talking to folks. Talk a bit about what kind of conversations you're having or hearing here. What kind of audience? What has been your experience?
One of the biggest things I'm seeing here is the AI. I mean, I think it's everywhere. AI is, you can't escape it. So I think that's a really big piece to the conversations that are happening here. Another thing that I've noticed here is internal developer platforms. IDP is another really big thing that a lot of folks are talking about. I was here yesterday, so there are a lot of other vendors and other booths out there. And it was interesting to get a take on how they're solving those problems and how they're developing platforms for their developers themselves so that they can have self-service tooling, so they can have kind of a la carte off the shelf, golden pass, those sorts of things. And it's really interesting to see how those things are coming to light and how we can use those to our advantage to better the developer experience.
Can you talk about from Qarik's perspective, what does platform engineering mean? And also, what work your folks are doing in the GenAI. Now, GenAI, we can see either as a workload, or GenAI is to leverage your services, or you do consultancy to help organizations to take advantages of some of these emerging technologies or emerging trends.
So I think Qarik looks at platform engineering a lot like most other places. I think it's all about enabling developers and enhancing the developer experience, and I think that's kind of the approach that we take. We notice that a lot of it's still in its infancy. A lot of organizations they want an IDP, or they have a need for something that an IDP would solve, and approach the topic with the client, and we try to understand what their needs are, and we try to get interviews, and try to get a good understanding of what they need and what requirements we can fill. The way that Qarik approaches GenAI is we're starting to build out these accelerator programs where we can kind of turnkey solutions, where we can have a customer or an organization come in and ask what we want AI, we know we want AI, how do we start it, how do we get started, and what do we need to get started? And that's where we come in with our kind of a prepackaged offering where we can come in and introduce that to a customer's environment and help them kind of help the customer get their feet wet, so to speak, in AI. So we can get to a customer and then we can give them that solution and then work from there.
When you planning to come here at KubeCon, what were your expectations, and did those expectations meet?
I think the expectations I have really kind of line up with what I think is important from events like this, and staying current. I think, I mentioned earlier, staying current was important to me, and what I'm hoping to see are a lot of real-world examples. I like to see how other organizations are solving difficult challenges with Kubernetes, and what I can maybe learn from their experiences, and I can maybe get some insights onto what their pain points were, and then how we can, you know, how I can take that information back with me and teach, you know, the folks that I work with and other. I was really hoping to see is again the AI space, how Kubernetes can evolve with the evolving industry itself, and how does Kubernetes adapt to that, and what are some of the things we can learn from as that adaptation happens and as the industry transitions and moves in that direction. And then I think one more was just improving a professional development, right? And getting together with a group of like-minded individuals, sharing their experiences, sharing their stories, and really just kind of understanding what others are working through and how I and opportunities to grow your professional network.
Can you talk about some JKE use cases, you know, and also what kind of pattern you're seeing when it comes to AWS to JKE experience, with or without naming any customers, what challenges, pain points, and how Qarik once again helped them navigate through these challenges?
Yeah, definitely. So right now I'm working with a large enterprise and we're migrating most, if not all, of their applications from AWS to GCP. Specifically GKE, and one of the application teams that I'm working with, we are doing a refactor of their application. So their application is currently running on compute instances, and we're trying to migrate them over to Kubernetes, specifically GKE. And it's been a really interesting journey to work with the team, because the team, they know their application very well, but what they don't know very well is Kubernetes. So helping them understand the differences between compute and the ephemeral nature of Kubernetes, it's a really interesting journey, and certain, so we talk about certain things like networking, differences in networking, what services look like, what service mesh looks like. We also talk about data and data persistence and how much data persistence is different in a Kubernetes environment versus a compute environment. And we also talk about deployment strategies, how we deploy to Kubernetes and what types of ways work the best for these application and the application teams. It allows us to think about opportunities for rollbacks. It allows us to think about opportunities for traffic splitting and things like that. And it gives these teams the opportunity to develop these strategies that help them test new applications and new versions of their applications more seamlessly. And once they understand the differences and once they get over that learning curve, the teams are mostly really excited about what GKE offers and what they can do in the future with it.
Matt, once again, thank you so much for joining me today and of course talk about Qarik and the whole ecosystem. Thanks for great insights, and I would love to have you folks back on the show. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. Thanks.